Well, it has been an unprecedented year. Crazy. With all the
stuff?
Yeah.
It's unprecedented how many times we've actually heard the word unprecedented.
Our dream vacation was canceled.
You got to keep the job you don't like.
You know they can see you?
But let me tell you all the no's, friends. No going to restaurants, no movie theaters, no movie theater popcorn, no state parks, no going to athletic events, no church services, and no...
Don't say it. Don't.
Hey, kids! You've got to be more careful with the toilet paper! This is all we have!
All the drive-by birthday parties, graduations, baby showers.
I will say this, I felt a little awkward throwing out that baby shower gift in the front yard.
You weren't supposed to do that.
It just feels like a wasted year. I said it.
There's just all the time at home.
Boom!
And all the time that we were made to spend together.
Hey, honey? Honey!
Leave me alone!
All the heart-to-hearts. Mm. Goodness.
Speaking of hearts, our son, Jason, right over there, said yes to Jesus. Right at that kitchen table.
July 17th, 2020.
You know, I guess it's not really wasted time because God didn't waste a moment of it.
I think I have the answer to what I'm thankful for.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What is it?
Everything.
That as we come into this moment of worship, that you are thankful for something, that there's something on your heart that causes you to overflow with thanksgiving to God today. Just a few announcements as we get going. Our YouTube live stream is not working right now, so for those, if you know somebody that would be watching YouTube, please let them know, maybe send them a text or an email. We will upload this service to YouTube right after this, and those who watch on YouTube can watch it at that point. Be sure to like this service and greet one another in the sections comment or in the comment section there, and just say tell everybody how thankful you are to see them online this morning. If you would like to follow along with a bulletin, you can go onto our website at fccmanhattan.org, go to the worship tab, and then click on streaming services, and you'll see a place for the bulletin. Would also like to invite those of you who still have stewardship pledge cards. If you are filling those out and praying about those things, if you would, remember to return those back to the church at your earliest convenience. We'd really appreciate that. The stewardship ministry team is looking forward to receiving all of those. And finally, on behalf of the discipleship ministry team, Ashley has put together these wonderful Advent bags. And they are for any and all families, young or old. It's not just for kids. It can be for adults. If you have grandkids, if you have just you're by yourself, this is a wonderful Advent activity. We would encourage you to pick these up. They are made and ready here at the church, and so you could stop by anytime from Monday to Friday from 8:30 to 4 p.m. and pick up a bag. If you would like one to be delivered, talk to Ashley. You can email her ashley@fccmanhattan.org, and we'll find somebody within the church that can deliver one of these wonderful super Advent bags to you. So now, friends, as we gather to worship, I'm going to invite Lucas to come forward and lead us in our call to worship this morning.
Please join me in the call to worship. Come in from the night. It is a new day, and this is where love lives. Take off your coat. Let the weight fall off of your shoulders.
For here you are known. Here you are loved.
Come in from the rain.
We can do anything together. We can survive together.
When the world unravels from under our feet, come in.
Come in.
Come in. God is here. You are home. You will never be alone. Let us worship the God who weaves us together. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in prayer. O O God, you are infinite, eternal, and unchangeable. Glorious in holiness, full of love and compassion, abundant in grace and truth. All your works, all of our works, praise you in all places of your dominion, and your glory is revealed in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Therefore, we praise you, blessed the Holy Trinity, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning. Okay, so this week we're going to hear a story from Job, chapter 28, verses 12 through 28. Now, have you ever asked the question, why? You ever asked the question, why? Yeah. I want you to think in your mind of a question that starts with why something. So you might think of a question like, why is the sky blue? Or why do birds fly? Why do dogs wag their tail? Think of a question and hold it in your mind. Can you do that? Think of your question. My question might be, why do little boys always ask so many questions? Okay, when you're ready, raise your hand and you can ask your question.
Why are red pandas so cute?
Why are red pandas so cute? Joe, do you have a question? No? No question? Do you have a question about cheetahs? No? Okay. So, well, today in our story, it's about a man named Job. Job had many why questions for God. Job had suffered greatly, and he asked God why these bad things happened to him. Job didn't always find answers for his questions, but he learned that God's love was for him. God's love for him was bigger than he could understand or imagine. It is as if God is bigger than what we can hold in our brains. It's okay to ask God our why questions, for God loves us no matter what. Do you want to pray with me? Here. Dear God, please guide us to always ask questions. Help us to accept the answers and the lessons we're given because of these questions. In your name we pray. Amen.
Now it's time to prepare our hearts and our souls to speak with God and to let God speak to us. As we sing together, thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Welcome back. It's good to see you all. We're going to continue in worship, and we're just going to come to this moment of prayer. And, you know, we are back just doing this live stream here just for 2 weeks. My hope is that after these 2 weeks, we can come back and have people back in worship in person, and also those who are watching online as well. But one of the reasons we decided to make this switch for these 2 weeks is because the Riley County Health Department has put out a 2-week challenge as of, I believe, this last Wednesday or Thursday, inviting everyone within Riley County, and really anyone that hears about it, but especially here in Riley County in the state of Kansas, to be extra careful over the next couple weeks as we spend the holiday season with, we make those decisions. Those are some tough decisions of how we're going to do that. And so it's not just where and how we spend our time, but it's also when we go out into public that we continue to do the things we've been talking about for months, because we want to stand up for our frontline workers. And so in this moment of prayer, I'm thinking about our nurses. I'm thinking about our doctors here in Kansas and all across the nation who are running ragged. They are tired, and there are hospitals that are running out of space. They're running out of supplies. Some patients that are going to the hospital for smaller things, minor things, have to be transferred an hour away because there's just no room. And so, my friends, I encourage all of us to back away from any sort of politicization of this and what's going on, and to do what we know is best and right, not only for us, but for our neighbors. And so in this moment of prayer, let's take a moment of silence and give thanks to God for all that God has given to us. And then I will lead us in a prayer and the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you today for your constancy, for your presence, for your love that never fails us. There's so many things in life that fail us, that let us down, but you don't. And so we worship you and we stand secure in the palm of your hand today. God, we give thanks for our many blessings, the ones that we see every day, and also the ones that easily escape our mind. Help us to be mindful of those things, to find the time to sit down and to write down all of the ways that we are blessed, all of the ways that we have been loved by you. God, we thank you for our church family. We thank you for technology. We thank you for the entirety of this year. It's been a year of growth for us, even through the pain. May we continue to be better and to grow in our faith, grow closer to our fellow disciples. And now together we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It comes from Job 28:12-28. But where does one find wisdom? Where is the place of understanding? We don't know how to get there. It is not to be found in the land of the living. It isn't here, says the abyss. It isn't here either, says the sea. It can't be purchased with gold. It can't be had for any amount of silver. It can't even be purchased with the tooled gold of Ophir or precious onyx or sapphire. There is no crystal, no gold equal to its value. There is nothing in fine jewels or gold equal to it. Not even coral or jasper come close to its value, and the price of wisdom outbids pearls. Ethiopia's topaz is not equal to it. It cannot be valued in pure gold. Then where does one find wisdom? Where is the place of understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of the living. It is hidden from the birds of the air. Perdition and death say, only a rumor of it has reached our ears. Only God knows how to get there, for God is where it is. For the Most High looks to the ends of the earth and sees everything under heaven all at once. When God gave wind its movement and measured the breadth and depth of the waters and made the rules for rain and designed paths for lightning, God beheld wisdom and named it, confirmed it, and tested it. Then the Most High said to us all, reverence for God, that is wisdom. And to shun evil, that is understanding. May the Lord bring blessings on this reading.
Thank you, Linda, for reading that scripture. This is the last Sunday in the liturgical season that we call Ordinary Time. And for those who have been longing to put 2020 into the rearview mirror, next Sunday actually starts the new liturgical year as we enter into Advent. I've always joked about Ordinary Time because it really is ordinary compared to all of the other seasons in the liturgy. Stretching from Pentecost in early June until the end of November. It is one of those seasons where after a while you just get kind of tired of the color green and you want to see another color and you want to celebrate the things that come along with Advent and Epiphany and Lent and Easter. But I think after this year I will not complain or make a joke about Ordinary Time ever again, because ordinary sounds pretty good right now. So what better way to end this particular liturgical year than to do it from the book of Job? This year seems just like the beginning of the book of Job, when one by one Job's servants announce that he has tragically lost all of his livestock, his children, and was afflicted by painful boils on his skin. I'll admit, when I was reading through Job this week, I had a moment of laughter when, after hearing about one of his donkeys, or his donkeys being killed by foreign invaders, the next servant announces that his sheep and their shepherds were all struck by lightning. That is some serious bad luck, if we could say luck in this situation. And so I'm ashamed to admit it, but I'm going to admit it right here and now. But this is my first sermon using the book of Job as the primary text in 10 years of full-time ministry and preaching. Because real talk this morning, I don't like the book of Job. There, I said it, I got it out. I've been sulking all week thinking about the task of preaching from Job. I'll just say it up front, I don't subscribe to the theological conclusions that many Christians perpetuate from reading this book. Hearing some preachers, you would think that there is a clear and defined systematic theology that's spelled out from this ancient text. But the truth is, this book is all over the map. There are no easy or black and white answers that are offered to the reader about the reason or the purpose behind suffering. And so if you approach this book looking for answers, you're simply not going to find very many answers that are going to satiate your curiosity or a desire to know more. At the beginning of this book, there is a heavenly courtroom scene where a figure named the Satan comes up to God, and the word Satan in Hebrew simply means accuser. And so the Satan comes to God and says, hey, you know, there's this man named Job who you favor. You say that he is just and faithful and honest. You say that there's no one else like him in all the earth. The Satan then goes on to tell God that the only reason why Job is like this is because you've blessed the work of his hands. And so if you were to take your protection off of Job and let me afflict him,
then Job would no longer praise you as God. So I'm completely uncomfortable with this scene from the very get-go of the book of Job, because even as a fictitious scene, it makes God so easily swayed by troublemakers, putting our well-being in jeopardy without much resistance. But I digress, because the book of Job is not a history book describing an actual event with pinpoint accuracy, my friends. The book of Job is drama, and lots of drama. And this drama invites us to find ourselves among Job and among his friends as they speculate about pain and suffering from a very limited viewpoint. That is our curse on this side of eternity, is that all of our speculations about pain and suffering and loss are from a very limited viewpoint. I think Paul the Apostle says it best in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12. He says, "For now we see in a mirror dimly." As Job and his friends theologize and philosophize about his suffering, they are indeed just feeling their way along a wall in a dark room, searching for a light switch. And so much of this text is just one dim mirror that we look into, filled with tragedy and lament, self-righteous speculation and assumptions from unaffected persons on the outside looking in. Our text this morning says that the wisdom that we need to see the bigger picture is often hidden from the eyes of all the living. Thus, it is no wonder that even though the book of Job is considered the oldest book in the Bible, it still strikes a chord with us today. Because no matter how much I want to dismiss this ancient literature as the work of primitive minds, far removed from our 21st century knowledge and technology, our lament during times of suffering and loss and tribulation is no more sophisticated than Job's. We may not understand the deepest mysteries of life and God, but we do know the depths of heartbreak. I love the words of Richard Rohr when it comes to the book of Job. He says, Job is a text that only fully makes sense to those who felt suffering, been up against the wall or at a place where, frankly, God doesn't make sense anymore, and we no longer want to believe that God has a plan. And so oftentimes, coming to read the book of Job, those who have not been through tragedy have a hard time understanding even the weight of this book. You see, this is all a part of our human experience. Love and loss, ups and downs, the good and the bad, abundance and scarcity, laughter and tears. They are two sides of the same coin of life. But it's usually not until the desperate times that we find ourselves reaching out to God. It's easy to seek God fervently when things are amiss. It's easy to say quips like, "God is good all the time," and all the time God is good when life isn't in constant turmoil. You see, my friends, faith feels really good when we can hold on to some semblance certainty. For it is certainty that we seek probably more than just about anything. Certainty that tomorrow will come and that it will hopefully be better than today. Certainty that we are safe, that we are loved, that we have a purpose and we have value, even in the midst of a world that seems to be falling apart. And so the question is, where is God when our world is falling apart? This being the last Sunday of the liturgical calendar, it is oftentimes called Christ the King Sunday or the Reign of Christ. It's a Sunday where we remember that Christ is all and in all, and that all of creation is centered in the love of God and Jesus Christ. I found this prayer, maybe it's a poem this week on Facebook, shared by the disciples of Christ concerning this Sunday, the reign of Christ Sunday. It says, "Don't look to thrones to find me. Look to the sick and the poor, to those who seek refuge, to those with less, not more. I am a king in hiding, with those in deepest need. So come and bind the wounded and find the ones who bleed." Through all of my grief about preaching from a text in the book of Job this week, I encountered the most beautiful picture of where God is to be found in suffering. If you read in chapter 2 of Job, verses 11 through 13, it says this: "When Job's three friends, Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite, heard about all the troubles that had come upon him, they set out from their homes and met together by agreement to go and sympathize with him and comfort him. When they saw him from a distance, they could hardly recognize him. They began to weep aloud, and they tore their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads. Then they sat on the ground with him for 7 days and seven nights. No one said a word because they saw how great his suffering was." The most beautiful parts of this book, where I find God in this book, is not in the call and response from Job and his friends or the call and response from Job and God. I find it in the journey of his three friends who, for most of the book, really offered nothing of substance. But at the very beginning, as they come and they travel and they meet with Job and they see his grief, they see his lament, and they join him in his lament. They tore their robes and they cried and they prayed. They sat with Job for 7 days and seven nights without offering a word. This is where we find God, my friends, and loss. And we'll celebrate this in Advent and as we move into Christmas, that God is not far off and aloof. God knows our suffering because God came to be with us, to sit with us, to heal us, to revive us. So whatever you are going through today, whatever trials, tribulations, struggles, may you feel the presence of God with you to heal you and to love you. It is in the name of God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
And your table this week might look a little different than normal for Thanksgiving, but the table that we get to come to, Christ's table, never looks different. It is a table and a place for all. So at this time, please gather your elements for your personal communion and hear the words of institution. On the night that Christ was betrayed, he took up bread, and after blessing it, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, it is broken for you." And likewise, after supper, he had taken a cup, and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant, spilled out for many for the forgiveness of sins. For as often as you take of this cup and eat of this bread, do this in remembrance of me."
terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and I will raise you up.
This past week, during our Common Ground session, we talked about the connection between gratitude and happiness. We talked about how there is a definitive link in psychology that shows that when we take steps to show our gratitude in words and in actions, that our levels of joy, our levels of happiness go up, and they stay up as we consistently find ways to give thanks to God. And so in our giving thanks, we do so through our tithes and our offerings. We do so by sharing of our spiritual gifts with our church family and with our community around us. And so I invite us to be ever diligent in not giving up and doing good. For as we continue to do good, there will come a harvest so great. And so let us, my friends, take joy in that fact. Let's join our voices this morning in our confession of faith. You can find it either in the bulletin that you downloaded online, or we will zoom the camera up on the screen. But I invite you to join me in these words this morning. I believe in God, the great sower, who weaves us together in community, collecting our loose ends and turning them into belonging. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who hems us in before and behind, catching us when we fall and writing us into God's holy narrative. And I believe in Jesus Christ, who loved and claimed the people society had thrown out, refusing to disregard anyone as scrap. I believe God has woven part of God's self into the fiber of our being, making us inherently worthy of love and belonging. I believe the fabric of my life is weak, that I am prone to error and need God's handiwork to remind me of love. I believe in the church and that like a quilt of different fabrics, she is designed to be as diverse and beautiful as God's creation. And I believe that when life unravels, God is there to stitch my wounds together, to hold me in the palm of God's hand, to tell me of love, and to invite me into a new journey. Amen. Let's sing our dedication song this morning.
This benediction. We leave this place going into a week of Thanksgiving. Give reasons someone else is thankful, and let us be thankful and remember to keep faith, stay strong, and know that we are loved. Amen.